Well, good morning or good afternoon, everyone, depending on what part of the country you're in. Thank you very much for joining us. Welcome to the very first itSynergy Hacking the Human webinar of 2017. So hope everyone had a good new year, and we're ready to kick it off with continuing to make you smarter when it comes to technology security. And today we're going to be talking about the Internet of Things, which is something that's gained a lot of press lately. So just a little bit of background about itSynergy. Let's talk about why it is that we do what we do. It's a phrase that is creating positive experiences with technology. So if you think about the first time that you maybe downloaded a new app for a phone, or maybe got a new phone or an iPad or some new piece of technology, and you have that moment where somebody shows you something new and you say, wow, that's really cool, or that's really going to improve my life. That's a positive experience with technology. And so the reason that we do what we do, what gets us out of bed every day and motivates us to come in and do what we do, is we want to create that feeling, that positive experience with technology. So why are we here today? Well, let's just talk a little bit about security. So in 2014, IBM did a study that found that 95% of all security incidents involve human error. CompTIA followed that up in 2015 with another study where they found that human error accounts for 52% of the root cause of security breaches. In that same year, Experian also did a study finding that employees and negligence are the leading cause of security incidents, but remain the least reported issue. And so our goal here in the next 14 minutes is just to give you some quick action items that you can take away and help you be a little bit smarter when it comes to security around technology. And I would encourage you to join us on the second Thursday of every month at 11:30 a.m. Arizona time for a new 15-minute topic. So, we ready? Let's do it. Today's topic is the Internet of Things. So let's start out talking about, well, what's the problem? Why are we talking about Internet of Things? Well, on October 21st of last year, so about 3 months ago, one of the largest attacks in Internet history was launched. And it took some pretty major sites like Twitter, Amazon, Netflix, etc., offline for several hours. So these sites were completely inaccessible for several hours. The primary attack method used in that attack was to install freely available malware. So there's bad guy software out there that was freely available on the internet. And that software was installed on hundreds of thousands of unsecured IoT or Internet of Things devices. And when that happens, those devices then become effectively soldiers in a hacker's army. And the hacker can send commands to those devices to be carried out against targets. And so according to the research firm Forrester, which is one of the big research houses, that attack is and this is a quote from them, it's the tip of the iceberg when it comes to using connected devices to do harm. So what that particular attack did was just take some major websites offline for a couple hours, Twitter, Amazon, etc. But Forrester says that's just the tip of the iceberg in terms of the bad things that can happen. And they also say, this was an interesting statistic to me, is that new categories of smart home tech will drive Internet of Things growth faster than replacement products. So in other words, Internet of Things is still in such an early stage that growth is being driven by people continuing to add new devices in new categories in their homes and businesses, and not simply they're just buying an updated version or a replacement device. So we're still in a very early stage of Internet of Things, and there's still quite a bit of growth yet to come. Okay, so you say, I'm in. I understand the problem. What can I do? Well, the very first thing you need to do is you've got to make a list of what's connected to your network. And this can be at home and at the office. And this answer isn't always obvious. So we've got some examples here of some things that you need to think about that are probably connected to the network, but maybe you haven't even thought about it. So you've probably got some type of internet router or firewall or wireless device, or maybe all three of those things combined into a single device. You may have a DVR or a digital video recorder, something that records TV shows and is connected to the internet. You may have cameras, security cameras, surveillance cameras, baby cameras, all kinds of different cameras that a lot of times are connected to the internet. I know that this is becoming more and more popular, is having your doorbell connected to the internet. Ring is probably the most popular product there. I have one on my house. Appliances more and more are starting to connect to the internet. So washing machines, refrigerators, ovens, etc. You've also got to think about storage. So a lot of people maybe have some type of a personal media server to store photos, music, that type of thing, or maybe just some type of a network storage device where they're storing all those things. So you've got to think about those devices. You've got to think about all of your media sources. So things like Apple TV or an Amazon Fire Stick or Roku or all of these various devices that people are using to bring content into their living room are oftentimes connected to the internet. And then the one other thing that you've got to think about as well is sometimes there are devices that are not directly connected to the internet, but they are connected via Bluetooth to a phone or a computer, and then that phone or computer then connects to the internet. And so we've got to think about those devices too. So a great example of this would be a lot of the fitness trackers, like a Fitbit or that type of thing. Oftentimes those are connected to your phone, and your phone is then connected to the internet. And so by pass-through, that kind of gives those devices a connection to the internet as well. And so once you've made that list of everything that's connected to the internet, the first thing you've got to figure out is, do you have control? Do you have any way to configure those devices? And so you've got to figure out, can I log on to that device? Are there any configuration options that I can set? So some of those devices come with a DVD or a CD for configuration that's right in the box. And if they have that, you can likely log on and get control of that device. Some of them have what's called an IP address, which you can plug into your web browser to access the device. So you could type that http://, and then the IP address. Here's an example of one of those, and that may allow you to get in and configure that device. Oftentimes, that IP address is something that's found in the documentation that comes with the device. And if you're talking about a router or a firewall that's on your home or office network, you can oftentimes look in the network configuration for your computer, and you want to look for what's called a gateway. And so you do this differently depending on what type of computer or device that you're using. It's different on a Mac or a PC or an iPad. But if you can dig into the network settings, you want to look for a gateway. And that gateway will give you an IP address, which you can then often plug into the web browser, as in the previous example, and get access to that device. So if you don't have any of those things, the next question to ask is, does the device have an app to control it? So a lot of these internet-connected devices, like cameras and those types of things, come with some type of an app that give you access to the device. And so that would be another way that you might have control of that device. And then sometimes on the device itself, there will be a screen or some buttons or some configuration ability or some way to configure it directly from the device itself. So, for example, if we take an Apple TV, that comes with a remote, and you can actually configure that on your TV screen. And so that might be another way that you would be able to control these devices. So if you decide that you do have control, let's talk about what you need to do to help secure that device. So the first thing you need to do is log on to the device interface. And so that would be using that IP address or using that DVD or some of those other things we talked about on the previous slide. A number one important step to take is change the password. By far, and in this attack that we described in October of last year, the way that that attack happened was by the bad guys taking advantage of devices that still had the default username and password that came out of the box from the manufacturer. And so simply by changing the password to something that is not there by default from the factory, that alone will increase the security quite a bit, because those default passwords that come from the factory are all well known. You can look them up on the internet with a simple search. And so that makes it very easy for the bad guys to take advantage of that. Usually you'll find the place to change the password under some type of an administration section. Obviously, it's different for every type of device, but if you kind of click around in there, sometimes there'll be like an administration choice, and that's where you can find the option to change the password. The other thing that you want to do as long as you're in there is look for other passwords or options that you might configure. So for example, you might want to change things like a wireless network password. So if you're logging onto your wireless router at home or the office, you want to change the password that people would use to connect to your wireless network. And again, we want to change it to something that's different than what comes by default from the factory. The next thing that you want to look for is a feature called UPnP, which stands for Universal Plug and Play. And so again, you'll have to dig around in the settings a little bit, but look and see if that device has UPnP. And if it does, turn it off. UPnP is a feature that allows devices to automate some of their configuration, and it's a feature that's designed to make things easier to configure. The problem is it also makes it a lot easier for bad guys to hack in and possibly reconfigure your router to settings of their liking. And so even though UPnP is designed to make things easier, unfortunately it wasn't designed with security in mind, and so at this point, our recommendation would be to turn it off. You also want to disable, if there is an option in there anywhere, a feature called remote administration. Again, when you dig in, sometimes you'll see an option for remote administration. You want to make sure that that is turned off or disabled. And then finally, you want to disable any type of what's called WAN traffic. And basically, that's traffic that's coming in from the outside. And so you want to make sure that your devices that are connected to the internet are not responding to anything coming in from the outside. So I'm going to give you some technical terms here that you can look for when you're digging around in that configuration. You want to look for things like ICMP or responding to ping requests. So again, some very technical terms, but a lot of times if you dig around in the settings, you'll find those things buried in there somewhere, and just make sure all of that stuff is turned off. So now let's talk about, well, what if you can't log in? What if it doesn't have a DVD or an IP address or something like that? Then what do you do? Well, the first thing is, as I mentioned before, a lot of these devices come with an app that allows you to access the device, whether it's a camera or a doorbell or whatever else it is. And if it has an app, most likely you have signed up with that vendor for some type of an account when you originally configured the device. And so what you need to do there is make sure that you have a strong password, and we've talked in previous webinars about strong passwords, so you can go back and look at those, but make sure you have a strong password for the account and make sure it is unique. So we've also talked in previous webinars about not reusing passwords, so make sure that you, whatever password you assign to that account, you're not using anywhere else. The next thing you want to do is read the documentation to find out if there is any way to turn features off. So if you can't figure out how to get into that device, maybe there's some instructions that came with it, and maybe it gives you a way to turn things off. And then finally, if you have an advanced router or firewall, and this gets a little bit technical, so you may need to hire somebody to help you with this, you want to put those devices on a separate or guest network and keep them segregated from other things in your home or office, like computers and phones. So again, this is a little bit more of an advanced thing. You may need somebody to help with this. Also, a lot of times the very basic home firewalls don't even have this capability. But if you do have that capability, it's something that you want to make sure that you're using. Next thing that's very important when it comes to the Internet of Things is make sure that you have installed your updates. Believe it or not, even if you've just taken a brand new device out of the box and plugged it in for the very first time ever, there's a good chance that an update is available from the manufacturer and has already been released. And so you want to make sure that you install those updates when you're very first setting up the device. Secondly, you also want to set a reminder for yourself to check for updates on a regular basis. I would recommend for home-based devices, you probably want to check that a minimum of quarterly. If you check it more often, that certainly doesn't hurt anything. But a minimum of quarterly, you want to check for those updates. And obviously, if it's in a business environment, you're going to want to check even more often than that. So let's talk about how do you update if you want to install those updates. So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to log on to the vendor support site. So whoever you bought that device from, whether it's a Cisco or a Linksys or a Netgear or whatever else, you're going to want to go out to their website. And you're going to want to download what's called a firmware file for your device. So if you dig into their website and go under the support section, you're usually going to see something for firmware downloads, and then it will ask you what type of device you have, what's the model number. You'll pick out your model number, and then it'll give you a file called firmware that you can download to your computer. So once you've downloaded that file, you're then going to want to log onto the device, like we talked about before when you logged on to change the password, and you're going to look for an update section. Sometimes that is located under the administration area that we talked about before, the same type of area where you change your password. Sometimes it may be someplace different, but you want to look for a place where you can update that device. And then what you're going to do is you're going to browse to the file that you downloaded and install it. So when you get to that update screen, there'll be a browse button. You'll hit browse and you'll go out to the file that you downloaded and put it in there and then hit OK. and that will install that file on that device. So when you're doing that, though, you do need to be careful, because when you're installing firmware, what you're effectively doing is installing a new operating system on the device. So it's almost like if you took your computer or your laptop and installed a brand new version of Windows on there. That's a pretty major deal, and so that's what you're doing on this device. So some things you want to be careful about is you want to make sure not to interrupt the process. Don't reboot or close your browser in the middle of it, or pull the power on the device or anything like that. You want to make sure you have continuous power to the device, so don't pull the plug out. And you may even, if you have one available, connect an uninterruptible power supply or UPS or a battery during the update process, so that if the power in your home or office flickers during that update process, that the device continues to have power. Because if there is an interruption during that update, sometimes, in rare cases, that can render the device unusable. And so it's just something you want to be careful about. And then some devices give you an option to make a backup. So if you have that option, make sure you take that option. And then the next thing you want to do is you want to make sure that you've got a firewall, whether we're talking about home or business. If you're at all concerned about the digital security of your home and family, when you're purchasing a firewall, that's not the place to look for the best deal, the lower price, lowest price, etc. So you want to make sure it's a name that you've heard of before, so things like Linksys, Cisco, Netgear, etc. I'd recommend avoiding D-Link devices, because the Federal Trade Commission just sued D-Link because they were releasing unsecured devices, so that's probably not a real good choice at this point. And if you want to take the security very seriously, maybe you're a high-profile individual or you're particularly concerned about security, you may even want to look at some higher-end brands like a SonicWall. So that's certainly going to cost you more than some of the Netgears and Linksys, but there's a reason that it costs more. You're going to get a lot more functionality out of that. And then the final thing is, don't forget the office. So if you've got to remember that Internet of Things is everywhere and it's expanding every day. So certainly you've got to think about your house. You've probably got a lot of Internet of Things at your house, but you got to make sure that you secure your business too. So you've got to think about things like surveillance systems, if you've got cameras in the office. Maybe you have some type of device that records video from those cameras. You've got to think about alarms, access control systems, display panels. So maybe you have a building lobby that's got a TV in it with a directory, or maybe you've got a TV in your lobby when people come to visit you. You've got to think about environmental monitoring, so fire alarm systems, temperature monitoring systems, all those types of things. And then building and mechanical systems like air conditioning, HVAC, fire, all those things. Those all are often more and more now connected to the Internet. And so all these precautions that we've talked about, you got to make sure to take all those precautions at the office too. So thank you very much for joining us today. Our next webinar is going to be on February 9, again at 11:30 Arizona time. The registration is live right now, so you can go out right this minute and register for it at itsynergy.com/webinar. The topic is password management. We're going to give you very detailed step-by-step instructions on setting up a password management system and how to keep track of all that and all the details you need to get yourself in good shape when it comes to password. Just a reminder that our webinars are the second Thursday of every month at 11:30. There is me. There is my contact information. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out. And if you know anybody who would benefit from these webinars, please don't hesitate to share it. So with that, I will conclude. Thank you all for joining us today. Have a great month, and we'll talk to you next month.